Hello and welcome to a special episode of To The Point. This month marks the first anniversary of the Modi government. How is it fared? What are its successes? What are its disappointments, weaknesses and failures? And how is the government viewed, and more importantly, how is the Prime Minister himself viewed? Those are the key issues I shall put today to one of India's greatest right-wing thinkers, a member of Atal Bihari Vajpayee's cabinet, himself once upon a time a great editor, a highly regarded author and now a much valued columnist, Arun Shourie. Arun Shourie, before we discuss Mr. Modi's government in detail, let me ask you a simple scene-setting question. What impression have you formed of the first year in office? Are you impressed or are you disappointed?
Well, and for effort, to the Prime Minister, 100%. For the other ministers, I don't know what they are doing or what is happening. On foreign policy, very high marks, focus, energy. On the economy, directionless, great disappointment. On social relations, great anxiety. On institutions, anxiety bordering on apprehension. So, good in parts.
Let's take each of those elements of that very comprehensive answer one by one so that the audience can understand your thinking in greater detail. And let's start with foreign policy, where many people believe Mr. Modi has achieved his greatest success. The impression is that India's relationship with countries like America, Japan, Australia, France and Canada has improved, but also with neighboring countries like Sri Lanka, Nepal, Bangladesh. Is there a common theme that runs through all of this which suggests a reorientation of foreign policy?
Yes. I think first is energy that Modi has brought to this. It is exemplified with the response, the alacrity with which the government has responded to the disaster in Nepal. Second is, if you just see the countries that you were enumerating, Modi's own visits to Bhutan, Nepal, Japan, the Indian president being in Vietnam on the eve of the Chinese president coming here, Modi's visit to Australia, to Fiji, to the Indian Ocean states, then to Canada, US, Pacific powers, there's one focus. Yes, there is a focus, and that is China. So I feel that the inference has to be that Mr. Modi correctly regards China as the principal challenge for India in the long run and is sort of touching bases before going to China later in the month.
In your estimation, how important is this reorientation of foreign policy with China and the challenge from China as the principal focus?
It's a very important focus, but it has to be followed up. You know, India has great goodwill. India is not regarded as a predatory power, perhaps by Pakistan. But we also have the reputation of not following up on what is agreed to in MOUs and declarations and so on. A good academic was telling me the other day that we have a large number of MOUs with China also, from agriculture to space.
But why are you scared Mr. Modi won't follow up?
No, because that's the traditional way of Indian foreign policy.
So I would urge
that, yes, please ensure follow-up. If you have agreed to some projects, please execute them quickly. For instance, they are very important for our Navy, the Indian Ocean states, but you must do it quickly.
Now, alongside China, another area where people believe Mr. Modi has brought not just energy, but a new improved relationship is with America. It began with his visit in September to Washington, and then there was President Obama's visit as chief guest for Republic Day in January. People say there's been a sea change. A, do you agree? And B, if there has been a sea change, how important and significant is it?
I think it is a continuum. Since the collapse of the Soviet Union, Indian foreign policy is getting reoriented, and if you see from Mr. Narasimha Rao's time till now, there is a continuous thing of closer relations with the United States.
So there's no great break that Mr. Modi's made in this relationship?
No, not great break. I think he has brought a new way of doing things, like, you know, these big meetings in New York and so on. That's a new way of doing things.
So China is a new departure in a sense. America is a continuation of the past and building on the past.
Yes, China was a great apprehension that was swelling, and he has sort of now started to focus on it.
But in terms of the relationship with America, he's building on the past. He may be moving faster, but there's a continuum here.
Yes, but he has to move much faster, because I was told by somebody who's in a position to know that actually the Americans are feeling quite impatient. they were prepared at one time to move very fast on joint production of aircraft carriers. They are the best today, not Gorshkov.
So from impatience the Soviet is creeping in already?
Already, yes.
And he needs to be aware of this.
And they were prepared to give very important operational intelligence, which we have not grabbed.
So therefore, in other words, here, not only are the Americans becoming impatient and therefore we need to move faster, but we need to grab opportunities rather than sit on them.
Because you see, they'll then otherwise look elsewhere. Nobody is waiting for us.
So this is a bit of advice to Mr. Modi.
Not advice, but certainly my small suggestion.
Now, there is one area where many people feel there is lack of clarity. Some say there's in fact even confusion, and that is India's relationship with Pakistan, our most troublesome neighbor. Some even say the Modi government has sent out contradictory signals.
Yes, I think there are contradictory signals, partly because there's an over-optimism that every new prime minister has in that, yes, I can improve relations with Pakistan where everybody else has failed.
Is Mr. Modi guilty of that over-optimism?
No, I don't, can't say guilty, but certainly probably he might have shared that. At least the evidence of the steps that were taken seem to suggest that. And I would therefore plead that it is not a good idea in search of out-of-box thinking, in the fascination for out-of-box ideas, to ignore the institutional memory which is embedded in, say, the Ministry of External Affairs, of dealing with Pakistan, of dealing with China. You should actually also reach outside the ministry and look for experts who have devoted, let's say, their lives or many years to studying China, General V. Raghavan, Shyam Saran, several other persons, to reach out to them and give them the confidence that they can say things to you which may be against your instincts.
Two quick follow-up questions, or maybe three actually. One, you get the feeling that the institutional memory of the Foreign Office or of experts outside the Foreign Office is not being used by the Modi government sufficiently. It needs to be used more.
I don't know if it's being used. I'm not privy to that, but I would say, urge, given what I've seen in the regard
use
to Pandaji, in regard to even such a big person like Pandit Nehru, that yes, you must use it much more.
You're also suggesting by implication, don't rely on your PMO, no matter how large the PMO may be. You must involve Foreign Office.
And other ministries also, because after all, the PMO today is very large, but its talent quotient and expertise quotient is like any other ministry. So you can't have atomic energy and Japan and everybody else only from the PMO.
Are you also suggesting that Mr. Modi needs to involve Sushma Swaraj more?
I don't know the extent of involvement of Mrs. Sushma Swaraj as a person. I don't know.
The belief is that, in fact, Sushma Swaraj is perhaps on the margins of foreign policy making, though she's foreign minister.
And I don't know what the position is, but if that were the case, that does not bode well.
That does not bode well.
No, because every minister must, after all, they are the ones who are interacting with the institution all the time.
Is there a danger in the Modi government that sometimes flashes that come to an individual overnight then end up becoming policy the next morning, and that there needs to be more reflective, thoughtful thinking involving the institutional strength of our Foreign Office rather than relying upon a flash of inspiration that comes to one?
I felt that in regard to economy, certainly, to which probably we'll turn later on, but certainly that it is policy by ilham, by revelation.
And what about in terms of foreign policy?
I think there has been, as you rightly said, a theme that is being pursued continuously in regard to this. Maybe in regard to Pakistan, there were certain, okay, let's do this, why not try this, that was the...
Pakistan is the great failing.
Not the great failing, it's a thing that requires a steadier gaze.
So America is a success, China is a success, the neighborhood is a success, Pakistan needs a steadier gaze, Pakistan needs more careful thinking.
Yes, I think so. I mean, just wait for things to happen in Pakistan before jumping up and down thinking.
So you began your answer by saying that one area of great success was Mr. Modi's handling of foreign policy, and certainly the public perception was one of surprise that he was so adept and so adroit at handling foreign policy. But actually, beyond that, you're saying something very important. You need to follow on. Often India doesn't. You need to be aware that the Americans are becoming impatient. You need to grab opportunities when they give them, because otherwise they'll go away and give them to someone else. And on Pakistan, stop being contradictory. You need clearer thinking.
Steadier thinking, yes.
Steadier thinking. Let's now move from foreign policy to economic policy, which in a sense was perhaps the principal reason why the country elected the Modi government. A lot was expected. Many people say there's disappointment. Others go so far as to say economic delivery is the greatest disappointment. Would you agree with some of that?
Yes, I think so. Unfortunately, I would agree. That because the main, you see, the main, there were two, three main problems. And that was to recommence the investment cycle. And enough has not been done on that.
When you say that you're disappointed, explain to me why you're disappointed. What is it that you were hoping would happen that hasn't happened or hasn't happened sufficiently?
So I'll give it in just two, three sentences. Please allow me to do that. Investment cycle. Private investment was the key at this time. They were over indebted, the companies. Therefore, they needed from banks. Banks themselves were burdened with bad loans. So you had to do something about professionalizing the bank, recapitalizing the banks, taking away the bad loans into a TARP type arrangement, so that the market re-evaluates the banks and the banks can raise money and the whole cycle can begin. I'm just giving one example.
That is the challenge they had.
Yes, they had, and there nothing has been done.
Absolutely nothing.
No, I don't see that. So you know how much industrial credit has grown in the last year? Only 3.5%.
So when you talk to industrialists,
yes,
what explanation do they give you why they're not investing? Because Mr. Jaitley claims a lot has happened. Why do industrialists say to you nothing much is happening?
Well, because they don't see when they don't their own projects. Yes, they have been cleared, but clearance is one thing. The project has to come through with finances. I give you one example. It has to go down. If the factory is going to be set up in some taluka, you have to have follow-up there. That you cannot have without cooperation of chief ministers. That has not happened.
Let me put to you something that Mr. Jaitley enumerated just last week when he was in America at great length. He had a list of what he called the government's achievements, and prima facie, on paper, they're very impressive. For instance, he points out, inflation is down to 5%, fiscal deficit to 3.9%, the current account deficit to around 1%, growth, he says, has gone up to 7.5%, and then in addition, there's In addition, he says, there's increased FDI in defense and insurance, coal and spectrum auctions have happened, diesel is deregulated, land acquisition amendments have happened. And despite all this, you point out to me, investment isn't happening.
Yes.
And industrialists are disappointed. What is it that they haven't done?
First point, Karan, is every government at any time can give you a list, a long list. Second is, for many of these items that he has enumerated, really the credit is not of this government. Oil prices coming down, all other commodity prices coming down, that has helped. So I would not think that, please do not, you know, the task of leadership is to appropriate failure and distribute success. Here it is the opposite.
Aren't the coal auctions and the spectrum auctions the credit of this government?
Of course. And it follows from, the credit is that they have implemented the Supreme Court judgment on this.
So even here, they're following instructions.
Well, which is a good thing to do. It sets the stage for the future for allocation of this thing. But the figures that are being put out on auctions, please look at them carefully. Sethi and Bakshi, two authors, analyze the figures on coal auctions. 2 lakh crores garnered by government. It turns out that actually the receipt is going to be 6,200 crores. This is what would come. 2 lakh crores would come when the companies that have won the auctions produce coal at the rated capacity of the mines for 30 years. But it seems as if I've got it just now.
So over here, in claiming 2 lakhs has been earned, the government is actually misleading people.
No, well, they are managing headlines. Unfortunately, there is too much focus on managing headlines in regard to the economy, and that is going to rebound.
I want to come to the big picture. Are you suggesting to me, when you say the economy and the economic handling is directionless, that there is not sufficient thinking and planning, that there isn't a proper policy?
I think there is not enough reaching out to experts who know it. And there is too much confrontation with too many persons. Supreme Court today, Reserve Bank tomorrow, not a good idea.
In other words, experts who should be involved are not being involved.
And secondly, that much of the uncertainty that has been created is, for instance, with tax administration. It's just an example.
explain that, because actually that's a major example, and let me put it like this so that you can answer. Many people feel that the Modi government repeatedly, the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister, give assurances of a non-adversarial tax regime, of a stable tax regime. But FDI looks at high-profile cases like Vodafone, Shell, Nokia, Cairn, Vedanta, and they get frightened. And now FIIs look at the prospect of retrospective tax and say, what's happening? This is going back on assurances we were given. Has the Modi government mishandled tax, or is the Modi government's attitude to tax misunderstood?
No, of course they have mishandled it. How can there be any doubt on that? You suddenly send notices to Shell, to Nokia, to everybody, having said that you will not have retrospective taxation or retrospective dues. The Prime Minister's office itself writes that you should attend to public grievances, and the letter is put out in the public domain. And then suddenly you say 40,000 crores are owed on a tax that was there from 1987. And the government of India said thrice that it does not apply to FIIs, to the financial,
and now they suddenly changed their position.
No, but not only that. Then the FIIs withdrew some money 2 days. And they said, no. Those FIIs which are located in countries where we don't have, where we have tax treaties, we will not charge. Oh, notices have gone not for 10,000 crores, only for 906 crores. Then they said, but what about the debt? FIIs investing in debt instruments, because that's 3 lakh crores. So suddenly, yesterday, Mr. Jaitley announces in Parliament, no, that will also not come. So just one second. So that shows, he said, 2 din ke share hai.
So you're saying
40,000 crores, it will not be changed.
A very important thing. On tax, first of all, wrong decisions are taken.
Yes.
Earlier bad decisions, which should have been corrected, are not corrected.
Continued.
And now, having compounded the matter, you're backtracking by trying to get out of a situation which is a mess.
And you come out as bullies. If the other fellow just stands firm, the bully then just retreats.
So how bad a message has the government's tax handling sent out to investors both at home and abroad?
First, it alienated them, and now it has made them laugh.
Is this going to retard foreign investment in India?
Yes, because they require stability, they require predictability.
And that's not happening?
No.
So two major errors have happened. One, a failure to understand how you revive investment, as a result of which investors are not investing. And secondly, sending out the worst possible message on taxation so that FDI is also put off.
And third, that within the economic sector, institutional reform has not been paid any attention to at all, whether it is banks or the regulatory framework or regulatory framework within the financial sector, all of which impinges on investment.
So that's a third failing.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, the government says that its Make in India policy is iconic. They believe that this is a critical way of boosting manufacturing, as a result of which employment will happen, jobs and livelihood. Critics say that actually it's a great idea, but you're not doing enough to make it actually happen. The first thing that's needed is labor reform. But instead of the central government tackling that, all the central government is saying is emulate Vasundhara Raje's India. Do you agree with the critics, or do you agree with the government?
No, first, the first step has been taken with great energy, with Modi at Modi's speed, and that is that officers like Amitabh Kant and all have worked hard, and the simplification of clearances has been done. Backlog of projects has been cleared. But it has precisely the things that you were mentioning, not just labor reform, but many other things are required in this. And my suggestion on all that, including on land, has been leave it to the states. And you approve what the states pass on concurrent list or on the state list. Land is a state subject. Why are you getting into controversies in Delhi?
This is very interesting. On labor reform, central government accepted what Vasundhara Raje Sindhya had done in Rajasthan. But when Madhya Pradesh came up with reforms that went a step or two further, the central government objected.
Yes.
So it's not leaving it completely to the states.
Absolutely. So I have suggested earlier on also that under Article 254.2, there's a small thing, that what you should do is have a general announcement that on these items, which are in the concurrent list, when a state government passes a law which makes us as competitive as, let us say, Southeast Asian countries, we will automatically approve it.
This would have been one way of tackling difficult economic reform.
Yeah, absolutely.
Why has Mr. Modi not done it? Because you've suggested this to him.
Not only that, my suggestion is of no consequence, but this is what he was arguing for as Chief Minister of Gujarat. He was handicapped by his proposals not being cleared
in Delhi. So he had a good idea in his head. This is an idea he was arguing for when he was chief minister, but he's failed to implement it.
And we had been through this whole question of which part of the constitution you can do it under. He knows these things very well.
But then, this is intriguing. Why has he failed to implement something that he was advocating as chief minister of Gujarat and which was a way of ensuring economic reform happens? Why has he failed to do that?
I don't know. You'll have him.
I'll tell you why I asked, because when the Modi government was elected with 282, the first time a majority government happened in 30 years, the great hope was that we would see far-reaching radical economic reform. Yes. A year has gone by and we've seen a lot of tinkering, but the far-reaching economic reform hasn't happened.
And also because the direction has not been articulated that well. Much of it
is it just articulation?
No, not just articulation, but there's also because if you don't have the large picture in your own head, then it's just jigsaw pieces lying around, and when Karan asks me, then I make a picture out of it. Oh, this is my grand picture. That's what's happening.
You put it very nicely. Economic thinking is like the different pieces of a jigsaw puzzle all lying in a mess. The big picture to put it together is missing.
Is missing, and also many pieces are missing. So when Karan asks me, what is your grand plan, then I try to see what picture do these pieces make.
So when you're asked a question, you flounder for an answer.
You flounder for the answer, you manufacture an answer, you manufacture the headline.
Can I put this to you? Who is responsible in a government for having that big picture that frames economic policy? Is it the Prime Minister? Is it the Finance Minister?
No, all of them together, the government.
So together this government has actually not just disappointed, but in not having that big picture, they've let down the country. Because you expect the big picture of
the country is a big thing. But anyhow, when a person like Mr. Deepak Warik says that nothing has changed on the ground, well, then you better wake up.
The finance minister disputed that.
So, yes, he'll dispute many things. He's a good lawyer.
But your sentiment and your analysis Deepak Warik is a sort of concern this government should sit up and take note
Absolutely. And don't rely on lawyerly arguments. They'll argue one thing today and the next thing day after tomorrow. Remember our good friend Kapil Sibal? Where is his zero loss theory today?
Put this to me. Deepak Warik has said that in fact things aren't moving fast enough, that impatience is creeping in. What is your assessment of how industry and investors view the Modi government at the end of 1 year? Because they had a lot of hope riding on it.
They are hoping that maybe things will change 6 months from now, 1 year from now. So what a person whom I put great reliance on, he was telling me that this project is a plan. तो सोच प्लान करने की सोच रहे हैं
प्लान करने की
सोच रहे हैं और कुछ प्लानिंग कर रहे हैं
which suggests that they are a long way away from actually investing.
About a year, I would think 8 months to a year.
This also suggests that industry,
and if meteors don't strike in between,
this also suggests that industry is not happy.
And it also shows in the real indices, core index, core industry in production down, credit only 3.5% increase to industry in the whole year. All this shows, it all adds
up. I want to sum up this section. You said two or three very important things. The economic handling is directionless. You use that lovely phrase that it's like different pieces of a jigsaw puzzle lying in a mess, but no one has the big picture in mind so that they can piece it together. As you said, that big picture is the responsibility of the government as a whole. Industries, therefore, are not investing. At the most, they're thinking about when they'll invest a year later. They're unhappy, they're disappointed.
And also because of those meteors that have struck, like this taxation thing that you were mentioning.
So it's not a happy picture as far as the economy and economic handling goes.
In spite of some very good ideas.
But those ideas are not implemented.
As yet.
In which case, my last question on the economy. The government keeps saying that they've done enough to put the country back on a trajectory of 8% growth, moving fairly rapidly, they add to 10% growth. Do you accept that claim?
It reminds me of what my good friend TCA Rangachari once said, Jo hyperbole so nihal.
So this is just hyperbole?
It's like that.
So this government is talking.
It is, Professor Galbraith used to say, Indian planning and economic management consists of therapeutic targetry.
In simple layman's language, what you're saying is that as far as the economy is concerned, the government is talking, it's talking big, delivery is not happening, the results are disappointing.
Yes.
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 Arun Shourie, let's come to the government's handling of institutions. There is a great belief that many are languishing, some in fact are actually being neglected altogether. For instance, India doesn't have a chief information commissioner. We don't have a chief vigilance commissioner. Two of the election commission posts are empty. All the Lokpal posts are still unfilled. And perhaps worst of all, the cabinet secretary is about to end his second 6 month extension and no new man is yet appointed. Does that worry you?
You know, yes, it worries me. And there are 2 points. One is Mr. Meenu Musani used to say in a wonderful book called Our India, he had written that, no, in our case, cows are sacred. So we don't kill them. We just starve them to death.
Institutions are being starved to death
when appointments are not being made. And there is a lesson in that for us ordinary citizens, and that is be very vigilant. For instance, the right to information is a very important right. And if it is sort of squeezed by the appointments not being made, we must make it visible.
In fact, the Chief Information Commissioner retired on the 22nd of August 2014. Soon, it'll be a year that we haven't had one. The Chief Vigilance Commissioner retired on the 28th of September 2014. At least 9 months we haven't had one. These are damaging lapses on the part of the government.
I do not know how this happens. I'm not familiar with administrative rules.
So this is inexplicable?
Yes.
Is it unforgivable?
Must be some explanation. It is incomprehensible.
Is it unforgivable?
It's certainly incomprehensible. And certainly these institutions are vital institutions. Yesterday they passed an amended Prevention of Corruption Act. They have introduced, passed it in the cabinet. Well, you are not having a chief vigilance commissioner?
So this
how can
is
it
a,
be?
This is a criticism of the government in your eyes?
Yes, certainly. I can't understand why this has happened.
The government moved very quickly to replace governors. UPA incumbents were shifted out. Are the new appointees better in quality or just much of the same?
They're much the same. As my good friend Ram Jaitmalani once said, that all these Raj Bhavans and so on have become these old person's homes.
That's it?
And the institution has been thereby devalued. You put your favorites, I'll put my favorites. That's all. It's a retirement benefit.
When it comes to the bureaucracy, there was a great feeling in the beginning that Mr. Modi was reaching out and empowering civil servants, particularly because he said to them, feel free to come to me directly. If need be, you don't even have to go via your minister. Now, increasingly, there is a belief the power is being centralized in the PMO. Even notes from one ministry to another have to be vetted by the PMO first, and now people say he's disempowering the civil service. What's your assessment of the way Mr. Modi's handled the bureaucracy?
Two, three things, I think. One is some officers are certainly giving a very good account of themselves, and they are working, and they are able to put in good work day and night. I gave you the example of Amitabh Kant in condensing the forms, in doing this ease of business improvement. So there must be such officers. But in general, yes, the feeling is everything has to be sent to the PMO. And in the PMO, at least one report suggested things are lying. Because the PMO, after all, consists of the same type of civil servants. Its quotient of expertise and talent is no greater. So, wahan jaakar kya hoga?
So centralization in the PMO was a mistake.
The mistake is the other way. See, the Prime Minister relies on the bureaucracy as his principal instrument, not, for instance, on his ministers. But this bureaucracy is no different from, is very different from what it used to be 30 years ago. So it is not going to be able to deliver. Either you must induct experts from outside in a critical mass, or you have to find other ways.
So in other words, once again, you're saying that the Prime Minister's handling of the bureaucracy doesn't take on board the fact that the bureaucrats he's becoming increasingly dependent on are not as good as they used to be, and therefore they are slowing down things rather than speeding them
up. But there's one good thing that has happened just yesterday, a day before yesterday, that is these amendments in the Prevention of Corruption Act. At last, they have heard the cry that I've been trying to voice for 5 years, that you have to amend the Prevention of Corruption Act to shield officers who would have done things bona fide, and that's
one plus point.
Very good point.
What about the government's handling of Parliament, which is a critical institution? There's a lot of criticism for the way ordinance are used, and in particular the way the land acquisition amendments were pushed through by ordinance, as a result of which many of the opposition felt offended.
Yes, I think the ordinances were ill-advised. Because, you see, firstly, take the disruption of parliament. What is the excuse for the ordinance that the parliament was disrupted? But who is it, tell me, who said that disruption of parliament is a parliamentary tactic?
You're talking of Arun Jaitley,
aren't Yes, you? And therefore when the other fellow does it, it's not a, they are not being parliamentary. They are being very parliamentary now.
So you set the precedent, if others follow, you
yes,
can't blame.
Yes, and similarly on land acquisition bill. Today we are being told, I think it's correct, that land acquisition bill, as was passed by the parliament, would have paralyzed industry. But the fact of the matter is that the BJP unanimously supported that very act.
Now you need to explain why.
Why? And you can't explain it. I'm sure that the Prime Minister himself feels this.
After that,
they were not able to carry their message as to why these amendments are necessary. For instance, if you had actually shown, here are four defense projects which have got stuck because of this land acquisition problem, it would have been a case.
Is that the real problem with getting the land acquisition through, that they haven't been able to convince either their opponents or the country why the amendments are needed?
I think so. That's one. And the second is that
but
you have...
a failure of communication is an intriguing problem, because Mr. Modi is a great communicator.
But you see, you have to have the whole government doing it. So the point is, communication is one, your past support is another. And the third problem is the confrontation with everybody has meant, therefore, everybody says, okay, why should we cooperate with you on anything?
So Parliament has been, if I understand you correctly, not well handled.
I think more embracing attitude would have been better.
If Mr. Modi had, to use your phrase, embraced the opposition more, could he have got more economic reform through Parliament?
Yes, without a doubt. Everything.
So, in fact, his failure to embrace and reach out has effectively stalled his needed economic reforms.
Well, not only his failure. You see, it's
the government's failure.
The tone. I'll give you an example which goes even beyond the government. We just had elections in West Bengal, the civic elections. Mr. Amit Shah went on behalf of the party. What did he say? That I have come here to uproot the Trinamool Congress. Now, if you have come here to uproot me, you think tomorrow I'm going to cooperate with you?
In other words,
are not necessary.
If you need the Trinamool support in Parliament to pass your legislation, be careful what you say in Bengal about them.
But not only Trinamool, with everybody, every regional party, every even allies would today feel, no, these people are expanding their footprint so fast that I am going to get crushed. And therefore they say, yeah, get together ourselves. Inke saath kyun kare?
This is intriguing. So, the speed of Mr. Modi's political advance in the country is making his opponents in Parliament wary, and as a result of which, rather than assist him by passing legislation, they're ganging up against him.
Yes, and I had been saying for some time, everybody is focusing on 323 or whatever seats these people have. Please focus on another figure. That you have come to Delhi with 31% of the vote. It's a very big margin, but you've come with 31% of the vote. If you or those speaking on your behalf push the two-thirds together, then you are only one-third.
And there's a danger that could be happening.
That is happening. What happened in Delhi? And what is happening in Parliament? You have, by expanding so fast, by the language, you have actually frightened the others into a group.
Who's responsible for this?
I don't know. Maybe nature.
Do you mean Mr. Modi's nature?
I don't know. There's a wonderful phrase of David Hume that you and I should also remember. He said, who is it who has not been ruined by his own nature? So what is happening...
That's a very telling phrase.
But it's a phrase for each of us. But the phrase is that it's not just Modi. I think... Today, the government of India and the party consists of three persons. That's all. But three.
They are?
Modi, Jaitley and Amit Shah. These three, they work as a team. And you can't just blame Modi or anybody, but the problem is...
This Trimurti...
Is not get... Trimurti, big word. The three persons are not getting feedback from elsewhere.
They're isolated.
I think so. Secondly, they have frightened not just the allies, but their own group, their extended party, etc.
So the rest of the party is frightened or alienated from them?
Certainly frightened of telling them the whole truth. And third problem, Karan, is that as in all political parties, that if I take a wrong decision and the consequences are terrible, let's say I get Kiran Bedi in Delhi, we lose. It's regarded at that time as a master stroke of the master strategist. And then you are slapped by the Delhi people, 3 seats out of 70. Then people, who is to now decide that some wrong decision was taken? The same 3. So no corrective action takes place. So what do you do? You say, Chintan Shivar Karenge.
And the same 3 do the Chintan?
No, our Shatrughan Sinha, he says it very well. He said, wahi sequence hota hai. First it is the Chintan Shivar, then it is the Chinta Shivar, then it is the Chita Shivar.
You're making a very important point. I'm just going to underline it for the audience. 3 people effectively make the decisions. The decisions they're making are not just upsetting and alienating the opposition, they're frightening people within the party. Then when there's need for correction, the same 3 that made the bad decision
are
have to make the
court.
Correction.
They are the Supreme Court.
So the situation is actually far from improving. It's
and
becoming a self-fulfilling vicious circle.
And it is the situation in all political parties.
Let's move on beyond institutions to an issue of great concern, particularly for the minorities. Last year we had the Love Jihad campaign. It upset Muslims because the claim was that Muslim boys are deliberately going to seek Hindu girls to convert them. This year you had Ghar Vapsi and conversions seemingly targeted directly at the Christian community. People like Mr. Ribeiro were deeply upset and offended. The head of the Christian Church in India, Cardinal Clemus, spoke out about the churches being attacked and the fact that the government's response, he thought, was not sufficient. And on top of all of this, many Christians were upset, just ordinary Christians, when Christmas Day, one of their holiest days, got redesignated as Good Governance Day. Do you think the Christians are right to feel upset? Or are they misunderstanding?
No. When a person like Mr. Ribeiro, the sagacity of Mr. Ribeiro, a person who saved Punjab with Mr. K.P.S. Gill, these are the 2 persons who saved Punjab for India, and therefore a person to whom India owes so much, when he is moved to say that I feel like an outsider and an unwanted person in my own country, my dear friend, things have gone too far. No, they are certainly not wrong in their conclusion. We have to wake up. And secondly, there is great danger. Christians are here. But you are alienating. If you see this Love Jihad business and Muradabad riots, etc., then please remember the danger in this. IS is on our doorstep. All you have to do by creating this atmosphere is that if 100 young Muslims conclude that yes, bhaiya, yahan to kuch kaam nahi hai, we are not going to get justice here, ISIS is right, we'll have a real problem.
This I understand, and this is a clear message you're giving not just to the Modi government but also to the country. Let's come to Mr. Modi himself. He is, after all, not just the Prime Minister, he's very much the first man to have had an outright mandate in 30 years. Do you believe he's made a very comfortable, swift and good transition from being Chief Minister to Prime Minister?
Yes. For instance, as you rightly said on the question of foreign policy, he has certainly transited extremely well. On economic policy, I feel that he has his focus still remains a Chief Minister's focus, which is on large projects. For a Chief Minister, large projects and schemes, that's what development is. But in Delhi, development is policies. That transition, I sincerely hope and plead that he has to make.
It has still to be made.
Yes, it has yet to be made.
There is one criticism that's
and
made.
And also, I think there's one other point that is a change, and he may be realizing it now, and that is that when you are in Delhi as Prime Minister, people watch you much more than they watch when you are Chief Minister. You take a state budget. Who reads a state budget? But here, every comma of the central budget is read. So that's scrutiny, and which happens here, it must be a new thing to him.
There is one point that's been made in criticism of Mr. Modi. They say that as a political leader, he's very sure-footed. But the Prime Minister of India is also a moral leader. At a time when the country is anguished by things that are happening, it's the job of a Prime Minister to take a stand the country can rally around. But Mr. Modi was silent right through the Love Jihad campaign. He was very late and slow in speaking out when the conversion campaigns were happening. And although he's criticized people like Sadhvi Niranjan Jyoti for her language, when General V.K. Singh or people like Giriraj Singh have spoken out, he's been silent. When Yogi Adityanath and Sakshi Maharaj have spoken out, he's been silent. Do you think Mr. Modi needs to speak out more often and reassure people more often?
Well, yes, I think, especially because of what Mr. Modi does, this tweeting business. You see, if you are sending out, I hate this damn thing, but Twitter business, if you are sending out tweets on Sania Mirza's victory, on so-and-so, on some wishing somebody birthday, and then you don't do it on such an important thing, churches or Love Jihad, or then people draw an inference, which is not good. Ya to aap bilkul nahi bol rahe, then people don't expect you to speak anything, like in Narasimha Rao, Vinoba Bhave.
But if you're going to speak, make sure you speak at critical moments.
On the issues that are happening. For instance, when Mr. Modi's government acts very quickly in Srinagar flood or on Nepal, he provides that kind of leadership. But when on moral questions, then he is seen as silent, then naturally people kehte bhi kyun is par kyun nahi baat aayi.
He's creating doubts where he should be, in fact, removing them.
And yes, unnecessary doubts.
One area where Mr. Modi got a lot of flak was when he wore that monogram suit the day President Obama came. Was that just a lapse of judgment, or was it a critical mistake?
You know, lapses of judgment can be very critical mistakes. I cannot understand which person would have gifted him that suit. I can never understand how he ever chose to accept the gift or wear it.
Has it damaged his chaiwala image?
Because, you know, not the image. You see, the point is, you cannot take Gandhiji's name and wear such a thing. So I don't know how it happened. And it was very good that he got rid of it very quickly.
Can I ask
because
you a question?
It was clearly a gift.
Should he have accepted such a gift?
I don't know. I can't understand how this happened, really, frankly. I like him very much. I think he is the man today, the only person who can give us that leadership. This kind of thing, it's incomprehensible.
What about Mann Ki Baat? Is that a clever, good innovation that creates a direct link between PM and people, or is it just a bit of a gimmick?
I don't know. But it depends on, all communication is good, but you have to do, I'm not really familiar with what is going on and what the audience response is, but I have one suggestion on this matter. You see, not to do with Mann Ki Baat, but this business that I was mentioning earlier of being satisfied because you are able to manage headlines. You see, this, when the gap between projection and performance is so vast, then people see only the distance. They don't see the five good things that you have done. So one of the things I would suggest to the government as a whole, lower profile. Second, embrace others, seek other people's cooperation.
Those are two very good points. I hope he's hearing you. My last question. If I recall correctly, you used an Akbar Allahabadi couplet to characterize the first 6 months of the Modi government. You said, Plato ki awaaz to aa rahi hai, par khana nahi aa raha. How would you characterize the full year?
There's a couplet of Fez. Wonderful couplet. It's a sad couplet. It's about persons having made so many promises and then not lived up to them. So Faiz asks, "Ab aur kisi farda ke liye in aankhon se kya pehma kijiye? Now for another morrow, what promise will you make to these tired eyes? Kis khwab ke jhoothe afsoon se taskeen-e dil-e nada kijiye? With the false magic of what dream will you now console this broken heart?" So these promises that are made, the great ideals that are proclaimed, they are not costless. We have to live up to them. People judge us by the promises we made, by the ideals we proclaimed.
Arun Shourie, I think that sums up your attitude to this government to perfection. I'm not going to say a word more beyond. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.